fashion the future of health tech? This topic will be addressed by Mark Francis, who is an inventor with 12 patents in health technology. He's a venture development leader and wearable product innovator for Intel's New Business Initiatives Group. Before, Mark was director of product marketing for Intel's Digital Health Group, and he has worked in the venture creation and product development for the last 15 years. Mark was a co-founder of Life Care at Home and Life Source Nutrition Solutions and many other ventures. He has also served as program manager for the Boston Area Agency on Aging. Mark was educated at Harvard Business School, Harvard Kennedy School, and University of Cambridge, UK, and the University of Pittsburgh. Tell us what to wear to be healthy. Welcome.
Okay. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here today. As Renato mentioned, it's kind of coming back home for me since I live in Portland, Oregon right now. 20 years ago, I used to work for Ray Flynn, who was the mayor of Boston. Spent 6 years working with him and doing health and aging policy. Started out also as a geriatric social worker before then turning my eyes and attention more to the world of technology, new venture development, and product development. So it's been a pretty interesting journey. And through that journey, I think it's given me an opportunity to have some different perspectives in terms of kind of what's happening in the world of technology, what's happening in the world of product development, and what are some of the challenges in terms of not just designing a product, but designing a product that an individual will use, continue to use, and that's critically important when you start thinking about medicine and healthcare, because that issue talked about earlier about adherence and compliance is so critically important that if you don't have a system or a product or a service that has incentives, rewards, designed to have people continue to use it, the value starts falling apart. So through my travels and what I've learned, and I want to share a little bit today, is really at the end of the day, it's not the technology so much itself, it's not the product itself, but it's really to make a product successful and to have stickiness with the user in the marketplace, it really gets down to issues around design and usability. Prior to joining Intel, when I moved out to Silicon Valley in the 1990s through 2000, one of the companies I worked for did this really, really well. It was a company called Health Hero Network. Company 20 years ago started doing some pioneering work in the area of remote health management. We started out by doing some gamification with around the Game Boy, and we decided what we wanted to do is do a purpose-built product, but really do it in something that people would want to use, and also so make it so it didn't look like a healthcare product. So what we did is we created a product called the Health Buddy. We worked with a company called IDEO, which was one of the leading product design companies in the world. It actually ended up being in their IDEO Hall of Fame as one of the best products out there. And even now, 20 years later, if you look at the world of chronic disease management and what kind of products are out there, the Health Buddy still has about 85% market share, which is both great and also kind of sad, because you would think by now other products would be more successful. At Intel, I had the pleasure of joining our digital health group, working with the team there to develop a product called Care Connect, which now is a product available through a company called Care Innovations. That's a joint venture that Intel and GE set up. And with Care Connect, we really wanted to look at the whole issue of aging and how do we design tools and resources to help people age in place with the highest degree of social engagement, social health, and then also clinical health possible. And what I did with the team there is that at the end of the day, we want to win with design and usability. So we want to develop a product that while it's residing on hardware and while it's a software and service product, we wanted to win that the people who use the product, the clinicians, the non-clinical healthcare providers and elder care providers and the end users would say, this is the best using, best looking and easiest to use product that we've ever had. And that's what we look to deliver on. For the last 3 years after we spun off that company, I stayed at Intel and worked with our internal venture group called New Business Initiatives. And for the last 3 years, I've led a team there looking at the world of wearables. So some folks came to us and said, we're frustrated, we can't get into smartphones, we're always late, let's just forget about all this and do the Dick Tracy, you know, watch and be done with this. So we're like, well, that's interesting, that's something we might want to do, but again, let's step back and really understand what are the dynamics at play and then figure out what we might be able to do as a company. So we separated back from that and then started an exploration. So part of what I wanted to share here with you today was some of the learnings through that particular part of the journey. And kind of what I came to as a conclusion when it came to wearable technology, and this is wearables, whether it's for consumer product or for health, is that it's really about fashion. And if you can't create a product that is beautiful, that is elegant, that people want to wear, there's gonna be problems. Even something as wonderful as a Fitbit, which I use and others, and a lot of the fitness trackers right now that are kind of light health, the studies are that within 3 months, a lot of people stop using them because the value has diminished and the design is more faddish than stickiness. So as I looked at this with my team, I said, one of the things I want to look through is what do people wear? How do people wear it? What are some of the values that come from that? And how do you embed technology into and the use cases around that into what they already have, as opposed to coming up with something brand new? So we use a mantra of saying, you know, outside of tech enthusiasts and early adopters, people don't really want to wear a smart watch. What they want is a beautiful, elegant watch that's magically smart. So that's really kind of the direction and how we looked at things as we went around this work. So as we started working, you know, we looked at the trends. Technology is getting smaller. Technology is getting more powerful. We're in the kind of the phase of the smartphone now. Eventually, we'll be moving beyond that. And then we also have kind of the reemergence of wearable technology today. I say reemergence because for some sectors, it's actually wearables is already a pretty important piece of business. Healthcare, fitness. Kind of location tracking in particular. You have this reemergence of the smartphone, I should say the smartwatch, and then you have a whole portfolio of different types of products happening, Google Glass being, you know, probably the most well-known one and really becoming a platform for innovation, which is really kind of interesting. Ironically, one of the things we saw is that over the last couple of years, smartphones, instead of continuing to get smaller, are actually now getting bigger and getting more technology inside of them and a proliferation of apps, which is both great and also, as the last speaker said, a little bit challenging as well. So we said, well, if that's the case, will you still continue to have improvements in terms of size of technology, capabilities of technology? Where can we go with the world of wearables? And when we looked at wearables, we tried to say, let's not fixate on a particular form factor, or really try to say what kind of usages are people trying to enable and what could people do with wearables. So again, everything from clothing to glasses to wrist-worn wearables, there's a whole bunch of products. There's hundreds of products out there right now. We've tested and worn and tried out probably all of them that are commercially available as well as ones that are in development. For me personally, I like how this pushes much forward into embedded in your clothing, wearables in terms of thinking about electronic tattoos, ingestibles, there's all kinds of interesting things that are happening in this world. But again, what are some of the core enabling technologies? What do people seek to achieve from this? And what can that create in terms of value for the end user, whether that's a consumer, a patient, or whatever that might be? When we first started doing this, what was interesting is, again, 3.5 years ago, ironically, there wasn't even a single analyst report that existed on wearables. So that was actually good because it forced me and my team to go out and just start talking to people. So we got out and we talked to users, we talked to companies, we talked to investors, we talked to researchers, try to find out what in the world is going on in this space. We also looked internally within Intel, and not surprisingly, a big company of nearly 100,000 people, we had people who had been doing research in this area for decades. So part of what we look to do is really say, okay, let's be a central point to pull together everything we already know that we don't know, and as much learnings as we can get globally as well in terms of what's happening around the marketplace. Interestingly, we came across a fellow traveler at that time and had some interesting conversations, and that was the folks from Samsung. So as we were starting to explore this space, so was Samsung. And they were facing some similar type challenges of there wasn't publicly available information. We all wanted to learn. We've done a bunch of work with different innovation groups around the world in terms of fellow how do different groups innovate. They've been part of it. Google has, Facebook, HP, a lot of consumer product companies. So we had some good conversations. And what came out is finally some of the early reports started to come out, one of which was the first one that came out actually that I think did a pretty good job segmenting the market, showed that over the from 2011 to 2016, this market was going to start taking off. All these reports I think are a little frothy and a little optimistic, but directionally I think they're correct. And what they showed is that, you know, healthcare and fitness would maintain a position as two of the biggest markets, but you're having this rise of a new sector called infotainment. And a lot of that was going to be powered by the smart watches and then the smart glasses, enabling people to do stuff that they either never did before or they only currently do right now on their phone. So the dynamic was changing, and we thought that was kind of interesting. If you continue to see these reports coming out now, over the last 4 years, for example, about $1 billion has been invested in venture capital dollars in terms of wearables. You have companies starting to get traction in the marketplace. You have Pebble, which was a Kickstarter, you know, success story that has now sold almost 500,000 units. You have Glass, Google Glass, getting ready to go commercial. And you've had a lot of success from Samsung as well. So you've had some really interesting things starting to happen. So this is becoming a market that companies of all sizes are waking up to. Intel is working hard to develop some core enabling technologies for this market. We're also working hard with partners to bring products all the way out into the market. So it's going to be an interesting time for us and for the community as a whole. However, when we looked at this, one of the things that was stark as I looked at it is that there's all this buzz about different types of products, but no one's talking about fashion. And people weren't doing anything in fashion. But again, if it's wearable, it needs to be fashionable. And I would say, to such a degree, it has to lead with fashion. So we thought that was really, really interesting. So what we did is said, you know, it's good that the technology is starting to enable a next generation of wearables, but we have to go back and say we need to understand fashion and design to be successful. Okay? And what was interesting as we did this, there's a subtle color change here that isn't showing up here very well on the slides, but we also did some work seeing what's the technology adoption curve and also what's the fashion adoption curve. And ironically, they layer almost perfectly on top of one another. So if you develop a product that is not just innovative for technology, but also stylish and fashionable, you will get the fashion trendsetters and the fashionistas to pick it up and use it, which again, help the product then go more viral and go mainstream. So we thought this was quite interesting. So as we started doing our work, we said, who are those, you know, early adopters? Who are the trendsetters? Who are the influencers? And that's who we want to start to engage with. And again, we weren't fixated on the type of product it was or what the usages were at first. We really wanted to understand this. One of the other things I noticed and we decided to focus on is women. Because one of the things we noticed is that with all these different wearable products that were coming out, most of them were designed by guys and they were claiming to be unisex, but they're really for men, okay? Because most of them were too big and ugly for men, so they were really even that much worse for a woman, all right? Kind of the ones that were on the edge of acceptability were some of the more sports-related ones, which again, for that function would be okay, but you wouldn't want to wear it out in a social setting outside of what I think Nike and Fitbit and some of the ones have done. They've done a good job creating almost a Lance Armstrong bracelet type of community feel with their products. So there's almost a social status of wearing that product. But once those products become more stylish themselves, I think you'll see a big difference as well, okay, in terms of acceptance and long-term usage. So what we did is I told our team, we're not gonna do the 50th smartwatch. We're not gonna design for guys, we're gonna design for women. Because if we can create something for a woman in terms of where we need to take the design, the technology, and the usability, it'll be easy then to step back and do it for men as well. So that's a challenge we gave folks. So we wanted to do stuff such as people on a wearable don't want to interact with a keyboard. So how are you gonna interact with the product? So it made us really think about glanceable access to information. And I think this applies to any type of a wearable, right? Any type of product which you're gonna have folks want to use ubiquitously and have with them over time. So how do you do glanceable access of information? How do you do stuff that's voice triggered or easy glances or swipes? What do you do around charging? People don't want to be crawling on the floor to be able to charge their products and plug things in. So where is wireless charging? And what could we do as a company to push that forward? What's happening with displays? So again, a lot of products at first generation, is not surprising, are kind of chunky. So what can we do about curved, beautiful displays? And how about turning the entire product into a display? So we started to really think about things differently. We did this work through, you know, adopting what a lot of startups do, which is really focusing on what's the minimally viable product, what's the core use case that we're trying to deliver around, do a lot of iterative prototyping, and get out and engage with folks. So over the course of time, we talked to hundreds and hundreds of people, and then focused hundreds and hundreds of women, really understanding what are some pain points, what do they want if they're going to start using a wearable, and what's unique about a wearable that we could deliver on. What was really interesting as we did this work, we found out in our early work that both men and women were really interested in wearables, and women actually were 2.5 times more likely than a man to want a wearable, but they weren't buying them because of these issues around design and fashion and usability. So we saw that as an opportunity. So again, we believe that the convergence of where health, where technology is going in terms of miniaturization, more power efficiency, innovations in displays and charging, it's gonna create a groundswell of additional opportunities in wearables. We also believe that by focusing on design, and this is true for men or for women, that it's really gonna enable products to be able to have the success in the marketplace and become platforms for further innovation that we believe the market really wants. And we think that these philosophies are true across, you know, different types of products, different consumer segments, and different market verticals as well. So we believe that there's very much this convergence happening and a need to partner, and us and other companies are starting to do so. This is something that at the Consumer Electronics Show in January of this year, unlike what Intel traditionally does, where we show all of our partners, we bring out Dell and HP and others on stage with us. This time we had on stage with us opening ceremonies and Barney's and the Council for Fashion Designers, because we said this really opens up a new set of relationships, a new set of conversations, and a new set of product development opportunities for us. So we're excited to do that. We know that a lot of other companies have started to go down this path as well, and we really think that the future of wearable technology, and then as you apply that to health, is really going to be driven and led through fashion. Thank you.